Holland & Knight honors William J. Honan III with the 2002 Chesterfield Smith Lawyer Award.
Going forward, there's a certain amount of self-examination, and I try to appreciate myself and also try to appreciate what other people are doing a little bit better than I have in the past. Everybody comes with a viewpoint, and trying to understand that viewpoint is very important to me.
Understanding others' views, it's a trait of a good, solid legal mind. And Bill Honan has demonstrated this trait all his life. In part, it's what made him a leader in his profession. But that is just a small part of what makes Bill Honan stand out. His strength of character is not unlike the pillars he passes each day as he arrives in the New York office of Holland & Knight. Proud, strong, reliable, and constant. Bill Honan stands out for being a pillar of support for his clients, for his family, for his firm. Although he may first appear all business, this is a man that has learned to enjoy life to the fullest. But you can't put a label on Bill. He's a study in contrasts, a man with a seemingly unflappable presence, irreverent and glib, but at the same time, this is a man who loves to read and sometimes write poetry. A man you might find at a basketball game one night and the opera the next. A man who orders hamburgers with Dom Pérignon. Whatever the combination, it's proved to be a winning one time and again for this fun-loving kid from Long Island.
You must have been a beautiful baby.
I was the firstborn of what it turned out to be seven children. I have five sisters and one brother. There's sort of two groupings. The earlier grouping, of which I was the firstborn, there was two sisters after me and a brother.
He was always the one that everyone in the family kind of looked up to from early on, because he was very responsible as a young person.
And he was a good student, scourge of the nuns, but. Otherwise, he did well in school. He was kind of disruptive in class. He'd get finished with his assignments first, and he'd decide that. He never did anything really bad, but the nuns were. I was out of school quite a bit.
St. Bridget's was a Catholic school taught by nuns. They're very tough. I can remember a seventh grade teacher, Sister Clarice, and the first day of class, she called me up to her desk, and she started beating me. And to teach me a lesson, because she had heard about me from the sixth grade teacher.
But one time she had him by the hair and she's shaking his head back and forth, and she said to me, "Someday you're going to shed bitter tears over this boy." So I'd love to see her today.
Take out the papers and the trash!
If the nuns made an impression on young Bill, his father made an even stronger one.
A very strong influence. He was a war hero. He got the Distinguished Service Cross, which is the second highest medal you can get. So it was always, I felt that I had to work hard to sort of meet his expectations.
Well, Bill was above average, and that fluctuated according to his interest. In other words, if Bill just spent time studying, he'd be straight A. But that wouldn't be Bill. But Bill, he was very active, just the way you'd like a young fellow to be.
Don't hold back.
Bill, the model of a good son, most of the time, would be guided by his father's influence for all his life.
My father always led by example. And my father always was larger than life. My dad worked in Manhattan. He worked for a shipping company. That's how I got in shipping law.
I worked for a Danish company, A.P. Moller Copenhagen, and Moller Steamship Company. And I started, I was one of the first salesmen there when they opened up 1946. One of the biggest ship owners in the world. I started as a salesman, and I wound up as senior vice president of sales.
Bill would obviously draw upon a lot of his father's examples as he grew up. Self-discipline, structure, hard work.
Bill is independent in that way, as all of us are, because it was so important for us to learn on our own to take care of ourselves. And we went out and earned money at an early age, and we all have a very strong work ethic as far as taking responsibility for our own actions and building something for ourselves. We learned a lot of lessons like that.
But as Bill matured, there would also be traits he would garner from his mother, traits that would foster a very balanced personality.
She spent a lot of time with us, and she was gentler. She used to read to us a lot, and to this day I like to read, and my mother gave me that gift.
He was always reading, and he carried that all the way through his life, and I made him, he always have a book. So I said to him one time, I said, why are you reading that? It was some subject that, you know, a boy 10, 12 years old. He said, well, Dad, he said, I, in order to get the real story, you have to get both sides of it. Now, this is coming from a 12-year-old boy.
At that age, Bill was showing the traits of a good, balanced legal mind. And the law became a profession that intrigued him.
Yeah, the only thing he ever really talked about when he was younger about his profession or going forward was being a lawyer. So there was no, you know, he never really wavered from that from when he was very young.
He always wanted to be an attorney. That's one thing as far back as I can remember. And very few youngsters know what they want. Sometimes even in college, they still haven't decided. So I think he knew, and he worked toward that.
So in 1962, Bill headed south to college and to hit the books. The choice for college was easy. Always respectful of his father's guidance, Bill was enrolled at his father's alma mater, the University of North Carolina. It didn't take him long to become acclimated to college life. Before long, studying didn't seem to be a priority.
We're having a party, dancing to the music.
And I did pretty well. The first semester, grade-wise. And I joined the fraternity the second semester. I was fortunate enough to get into a Kappa Alpha fraternity. And my grades really tailed off dramatically.
Bill came through Rush at KU House, and I really took a cotton to Bill. I liked him a lot. I thought he was a really neat, funny guy. We had hump day party on Wednesday. Party Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday afternoon. I don't know when anyone studied.
This prompted a serious visit from Bill's father.
So I got to the fraternity house, and I knew where it was. I was familiar with. In the course of the conversation where we met, you know, hello and everything, I said, I'd like to see your room. So we went up to the room, and I'm looking around, and I don't see any books. So I said, that's strange.
So my dad came down and we had a long talk, and so I moved out of the fraternity into a dormitory, and then the fourth semester my grades were back up to where they were, in fact better than they were the first semester. So after that, things sort of calmed down a little bit.
Billy has a certain presence about him, and he's engaging, very quick-witted, very funny, and everybody just liked having him around because he always brought so much to the party. Of course, Billy's right in the mix of everything, you know, and he's always doing something. He was a character. Gotta have a good time.
Bill's college experiences were taking place during the turbulent 60s, and many of his contemporaries have stories of going into the service and fighting in the Vietnam War. He had qualified for student deferment and proceeded directly to law school, remaining at the University of North Carolina. But Bill did join the military reserves, and, well, he came away with another type of combat story, combat with machine. He'd been given the assignment to serve as an ambulance driver. There was just one problem. Bill was not exactly an accomplished driver.
What they didn't know is that I had never gotten a driver's license. So one night, someone had broken his hip, Well, I get in and I get the car started, and it's a stick shift. I've never been in a car with a stick shift before. So I said, well, what do I do? And he said, well, just put it in gear and let's go. And so we started up, and the thing started bucking. The ambulance started bucking like this. And so the guy in the back started screaming. You know, he was a lot of pain. And the guy who's with me, you know, he's watching me, and I can't get the thing to start without this bucking. So he starts laughing at me. Well, it is pretty funny when you think about it. So I start laughing. Well, and the guy in the back thinks we're doing it on purpose. So he's really, now he's upset and in pain. So we finally get to the emergency room. And so I remember carrying the stretcher, and the guy's trying to grab me. So he said, I know who you are. I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you. I went to the doctor and I said, this guy is really hallucinating. You better give him something. The guy says, no, he tried to explain it, and the doctor wouldn't have any of it, and they gave him a shot and he was out.
That was just one of many misadventures with Bill in automobiles. Another involved rear-ending his best friend as a teenager because he pushed the gas instead of the brake. And yet another, catching a military truck on fire by driving 60 miles per hour for an hour with the emergency brake on.
Well, I've never really had very good luck with cars, and maybe that's why I don't have a car today.
Thankfully, Bill moved on to choose a profession and a habitat that did not require driving. Upon completing law school, Bill returned to New York, and his path in life continued to be influenced by his father's guidance. Bill joined a law firm known to be one of the most reputable in the world for maritime law.
I graduated in June of 1969, and I joined the Haight Gardner firm that month, June of 1969. So I've been with the firm since June of 1969, 33 years.
Bill jumped right into things in spite of feeling a bit overwhelmed.
When I started at Haight Gardner, I was very much intimidated by being in Manhattan. I didn't have a lot of experience in Manhattan. I was pretty much a Long Island kid. And being in a suit, being with people considerably older and more experienced than I was, and also I was a little younger than my colleagues. I think I just turned 24 when I started working. So I sort of made up my mind that I'd work harder than anybody else. And so I would go 7, 8, 9 weeks without taking a day off, Saturdays, Sundays.
Bill's hard work served him well, and the senior partners quickly took notice. By his sixth year, Bill was a partner of Haight Gardner. By now, he and many of his young colleagues were becoming more and more influential in the firm, handling very important clients, and Bill's role as a leader would begin to take shape.
So we thought we knew everything, and we used to clash all the time with the senior partners back then. And it was lots of fun, actually, because they had to take us seriously. They didn't really like it, but they had to take us seriously. I think John Riley got on the executive committee first, then he went off, and then I got on the executive committee, and I was on the executive committee for maybe 12 or 15 years. Eventually, I became chairman.
Bill makes his rise to the top of his profession sound simple, but it was not. It was achieved through long hours and a dedication that resulted in a client base to be envied.
I got the world on a string, sitting on a rainbow, got the string around.
Bill's experience in maritime law has taken him literally to all ends of the earth. He's frequently listed in journals as one of the leading attorneys in his field. And as a result, he's asked to teach courses throughout the world on the subject of maritime law and contracts. In addition, Bill's got one of the most diverse client bases imaginable.
Maritime industry is and has been dominated by some very idiosyncratic people as opposed to corporations. And they're lots of fun to deal with. And you're dealing, for the most part, with foreign nationals. I was in Kuwait for a month negotiating a natural gas contract, which I found very much an eye-opening experience. I've been in Taiwan negotiating the termination of ship contracts. I've been to Norway over 100 times dealing with clients, a very diverse range of clients.
In fact, some of Bill's most loyal clients have been Norwegian.
We worked together quite a lot, and over the many projects that we had together, we sort of grew together from all possible sides you can imagine. And we just continued our relationship because we liked each other.
My impressions of Bill when I first met him, or even before I truly met him, William J. Honan III, Esquire. Well, I thought, he's the corporate lawyer, and I guess that's going to be the relationship. Kind of formal and remote and very experienced and professional. But that's not the way it was at all, because Bill is much more than that. Bill has been an integral part of the growth and development of Norwegian Coastal Voyage. Bill has been with his company as legal counsel for 22 years.
What becomes clearly evident in speaking with Bill's clients is that he is always responsive, enormously attentive, and gives them a comfort level that their interest matters deeply to him, even if his advice is not always popular.
It's probably almost 10 years that I met Bill when I was appointed as president of Norwegian Coastal Voyage. When I first took the position, and I guess I was tentative, and we were meeting one day and I must have been mumbling a bit, you know, or hesitant. And he looked at me and he said, "Act like a president, Roz." And I was taken aback when he said this to me. But I always remember those words. And in those tough times when I'm not sure or something happens, there's Bill in the back of my head.
Bill is consistent. I think one thing I really appreciate is he tells you what maybe you don't want to hear. He will tell you exactly where you stand, and seems to be correct all the time when he tells you where you are.
Through Bill's wealth of experience in international dealings, he brings to the negotiating table unique understanding and sensitivity to cultural differences that serves him and his clients well.
You know, it's been my experience that the way a case is, or the way a matter is handled by a Scandinavian is significantly different than it is handled by an Asian, for example. Not necessarily better or worse, it's just significantly different, and it helps if you are aware of that difference going in. The most difficult part and the most important part is to see the case or see the matter through their eyes. And if you can do that, you've gone a long way in understanding what has to be done.
Bill's experience and judgment has served him well throughout countless negotiations. But in 1997, Bill faced two very important contractual matters, both of which would impact his life and his future. Bill wasn't on the executive committee of Haight-Gardner in 1997, but he was appointed as lead negotiator in a very important merger. He'd negotiated thousands of deals, but this one would be quite different. This was a merger for his firm, Haight-Gardner, with Holland & Knight.
The attraction of Holland & Knight was that we saw a culture that was very similar to ours. There's a friendliness, a sort of a team attitude at Holland & Knight that we were trying to encourage at Haight-Gardner. It was the kind of organization that we wanted to be a part of.
And for Holland & Knight, the respect was mutual.
This was one of the great admiralty firms of the world, one of the most successful anywhere, one of the largest in New York and in the United States. They've always had the same standards of excellence, of hard work, of leadership, and of motivation.
And we negotiated hard, but fairly, never a raised voice. And we came up with an agreement that the Haight-Gardner side voted, if not unanimously, close to unanimously. And we merged into Holland & Knight on August 1st, 1997.
Where we expanded into all areas of the law. And we added real estate lawyers, we added corporate lawyers, we added employment lawyers, we added governmental lawyers, and the other things there. And so we tried to be full service. Now it's much more spread out, and they make money in all kinds of ways now for the firm.
My experience at Holland & Knight has been very positive. I am a better person than I was before I came to Holland & Knight. And I've only been here 5 years. I've met people who are very interesting. I've been challenged on issues that I've never been challenged about before. I'm talking now of diversity, gender. I'm much broader in terms of my perception of the outside world. The maritime world is a very insular one. Everybody knows everybody. And we're not really challenged the way Holland & Knight challenges you. And that has been a very positive thing for me.
There was another merger in 1997 that Bill viewed as positive. It involved a very successful financier, and this merger would put an end to Bill's life as a bachelor. Bill had met Kate Waterworth more than 20 years ago. And somehow, even though Bill dated more than a few women, there was just something special about Kate.
Have I told you lately that I love you?
Well, we met at a wedding. It was my roommate was marrying one of Bill's partners or associates, colleagues. And they had assigned seating, and Bill was seated next to me. And we just chatted, and he was very charming, and so we started dating.
You know, it's difficult during the years that we worked together. I think subconsciously there was always an attraction. Subconsciously there was always a desire. And I guess each of us acted on that about 9 years ago.
In 1991, we started dating again. And we got married in 1997. We just decided that, we would just try it together. And, it's been terrific.
And I always knew that Kate was in love with Bill. And I said this at their wedding. I thought he was frightened to death, but he was 51 and Kate was 46. And Kate looked fine, but Bill looked frightened to death. Everybody else was conscious of how serious he was. I did not think he was going to make it through the wedding, no.
I like New York in June. How about you?
Each having led very independent lives, suddenly combining households uncovered some interesting facts about Bill.
I mean, it was really funny. When we were cleaning out his apartment, he had probably 35 pairs of khakis and in various sizes. He donated a lot of clothes to charity. I think we had 21 bags. He loves clothes.
But Kate is quick to point out there are quite a few things about Bill that she relishes more than his affinity for clothes.
He's just terrific. Things about him, he loves poetry. He writes poetry. He has a wonderful voice, I think. I think that's a very attractive feature about Bill is his voice. I've seen him give speeches or eulogies, and he's very eloquent, and it's always well thought out. And he takes things to heart. He really, when he's asked to do something, he wants to do the best job. Another thing that I admire about Bill is he could have the worst day in the office. When he comes home in the evening, you'd never know that he was at the office. He'll come through the front door and he'll say, "Your Prince Alarming is home."
Kate is a wonderful fun to be with. And we have a lot of similar interests. We both enjoy playing golf. We're both huge Nick fans. Almost everything that I enjoy doing, she enjoys doing. She's an avid reader, as am I. We trade books back and forth. So we have a great community of interest.
Bill and Kate, in spite of their demanding careers, make the most of life together, escaping to their retreat in South Carolina whenever they can, and cherishing time spent with their friends and their family. And today, those cherished moments mean more than ever before.
And I just put the coffee down. Lynn, my secretary, said, "You client called from Greece, and here's the number where he can be reached." Then I heard a noise. It's a round noise, like a boom. But then out my window, I saw people running, not a lot, but some people running away from the World Trade Center, west to east. And then, you know, there was sort of a hubbub. And we turned the radio on, and it had been reported that a small plane, a Cessna, had crashed into the North Tower of the World Trade Center. So I called Kate, and I told her something's happened. I'm not sure exactly what it was. Then I called Bob Fagan. I said, "Bob, I think you're going to see something on the news soon that affects us. Not to worry, we're fine, and I'll report back." Mickey Canton, who is a friend of mine and a partner in the Miami office, called. I think her first words were, "What the hell's going on up there?" And we started talking, and then there was the second explosion. But the second explosion wasn't a round sound. It was like thunder, and it was very menacing. And it was you knew something terrible had happened. And then the smoke. And then shortly after, you heard the sirens starting to come. I hung up the phone with Mickey, and almost immediately, the public address system came on and asked us to evacuate the building.
Our building has a direct view of the World Trade Center. And we were in our morning meeting, and one of the portfolio managers in a corner office screamed, "A plane just crashed into the World Trade Center." So we all went to the window. And you could actually see the outline of the plane, you know, through the World Trade Center, and smoke and fire billowing out. And I got a phone call, and it was Bill. And he said, "Something's happened. We're fine. I'm fine. You know, we're going to evacuate the building." So, you know, I went back, and we actually saw the second plane hit, and then we realized it was a terror attack.
I asked Lynn, my secretary, to stay with me so she could go through the ladies' rooms. So we went to each of the three floors, saw that people left the building. When I walked out of the building and looked to the right, I could see the World Trade Center 2 was burning. There were about 25, 30 floors on fire. And you could see the flames. It wasn't just the smoke. You could see the flames. And people were jumping. And I averted my eyes. But you could tell from the crowd noises what was happening. I told the people that I was with, the Home Tonight people, to go home, that I'd see them tomorrow, because I knew we wouldn't go back to work that day. I stayed in the vicinity on Broadway for about a half an hour or 40 minutes because I wanted to make sure everybody was sort of away. And
Bill then proceeded to a nearby office of his friend and client Dick Corwin in an effort to make phone calls, but found the lines were dead. It was then that the situation turned from grave to unimaginable.
We started hearing this crackling sound, and then a deeper and deeper and deeper sound, and that was the second World Trade Center 2 collapsing. It started out as like kindling wood crackling, like when you snap kindling wood, and then it became deeper and deeper and deeper, and you knew exactly what it was. I didn't expect it to happen. I didn't even think about it happening, but it happened. And we were a few seconds later enveloped by this cloud.
Bill said they were going to evacuate the building, so I felt comfortable about that. But then we were standing there, and when the building collapsed, you know, it was a very scary feeling. And I was just out of touch.
And we walked down the 36th floor as we got out into the street, and it was like a nuclear holocaust. I mean, it was, you couldn't see more than 30 or 40 feet in front of you. It was this, it was all this concrete was pulverized, and it was like a fog. And you saw people walking from the direction of the World Trade Center, completely white, and obviously in distress. And so we started walking.
Bill managed to make it north to a friend's apartment where he was able to contact Kate. They, like most of America, spent the next few hours in total shock, watching news coverage, trying to make sense of it all. But making sense out of a senseless act was impossible. So instead, Bill moved into action.
We got home, Bill started making calls to account for everyone at Holland and Knight. And I think by the end of that first day, everyone but three people had been accounted for.
And after a while, it became obvious that Glenn Winnick was missing. And we have one of our staff members and one of our lawyers who saw Glenn in the lobby at 195 Broadway after the second explosion, speaking with some emergency people and putting on some gloves and a hat and running towards the east, towards the World Trade Center.
And Glenn was last seen by at least two or three Holland and Knighters heading quickly up Day Street towards Tower 2 to see what he could do to help, which would be a very natural reaction for him. He had been a volunteer fireman for 19 years, professional emergency worker, been trained in, among other specialties, building collapse rescue operations. And so it was no surprise to any of us, and probably no surprise to his colleagues here, that he would run towards danger as opposed to away from it, because it was his natural instinct to go and help.
And that's the last time anybody saw him. Glenn's missing still.
Glenn was my younger brother by 3 years, and Glenn was certainly a very proud lawyer, a proud partner of Holland and Knight. He was very glad to be here, and as his family, we were very proud of his accomplishments in the legal field and also what he did in the community. He loved being a lawyer. He certainly loved being a lawyer, and I think the environment here helped him love his profession very much.
And he became a partner, and he was a capital partner. So he was, I think he was with us for 10 years. Oh, wonderful attorney, he was a litigator, very popular. I attended, along with many, many of my colleagues, the services that were held at the synagogue out in Jericho, Long Island. And at the firm held a service for Glenn at Kehillath Jeshurun.
The support of Holland and Knight, and led by Bill in this case as the main person we dealt with on a regular basis, was really pretty remarkable. And in some ways it was unexpected. While we understood his role here, we certainly didn't have firsthand personal knowledge about the character of the people that Glenn got to work with day in and day out. We very quickly found that Glenn stayed at Holland and Knight for good reasons, that the character of the people in this company was truly extraordinary. Keep me free from bird eye, give me hope and help me cope with this heavy load.
In spite of the terrible sadness and concern that Holland and Knight faced in the days following the crisis, business needed to move forward. Bill Honan had risen to the challenge. He had called together a team, and from his apartment, they devised a strategy that got the Holland and Knight New York offices back in business.
And it was very difficult, and I talked to all of those people, and they told me that Bill Honan had done a fabulous, marvelous job of getting them through for the first 6 to 10 weeks after those bombings and explosion, and they said he worked around the clock. He did it.
I'm in a New York state of mind. Somewhere beyond the sea.
As usual, today Bill finds himself buried in his work. And one project that occupies a great deal of his time is proving to be one of the most unique and challenging of his career. Residence C, a collection of privately owned apartments aboard the luxury vessel, The World.
It's a big project. We started, of course, with the general business plan. We started from that business plan to develop the documents that we needed to sell these apartments on board ship to the clients, and that was all Bill's work.
Our initial challenge in Residence C was to come up with a ownership mechanism that made sense from a maritime perspective. So we couldn't use cooperative apartment law and we couldn't use condominium law. So we created something called residency rights. And residency rights are not real estate, they're personal property, and it's something you purchase. And you have the right to enjoy it for 50 years, which is roughly the useful life of the vessel.
Bill has the special quality, which I find is somewhat rare, unfortunately, in many, many of his profession, and that is that he's able to combine the commercial with the legal.
No, I would say that this has been the most important matter that I've handled, because it is a case where it is a matter in which we created something that never existed. And I think it's a concept that will be successful and that it trumps the high end of the cruise market. You cannot get any higher end than this.
There are places I remember.
With all the support Bill has provided over the years to his friends, his clients, his firm, and his family, it's not surprising that there are many who are eager to share words of support and praise.
He's a very generous and caring person. You know, in times of trouble, and there have been many over the years, he's the one that that we go to. And anytime there's an important decision in my life, I go to Bill to discuss it, because I know that I'll get a good, solid, honest answer that I can depend on.
Our family is so thrilled that Bill is winning the Chesterfield Smith Award. We always knew that he would grow up involved in the law, and we're just so happy that he's on the right side of it.
One of Bill's finest qualities is generosity. Generosity of spirit, I think generosity of time, and generosity, in fact, of helping friends in need. It's a word that permeates, I think, his character. I think he's a wonderful person. Wonderful for Holiday Night.
I mean, he's very devoted to his work, and yet out of this devotion comes a special kind of informality and casualness. So he does have this special dedication, which I totally respect and admire.
And I like him very much. And if a mother-in-law says that, that says a lot. I always thought he was going to be a great success from the first time I met him, and he has become very successful.
What I admire about him is his professionalism. I mean, even just for a simple firm meeting, I mean, he prepares, and I really admire that. I mean, I'm someone who kind of does things on the fly, but he is really always prepared.
And on being honored with the Chesterfield Smith Lawyer Award, there are more than a few congratulations.
I am very proud, and each thing that comes along, he worked so hard, and he just deserves everything that he's gotten. So I am very proud, though. And it just, he's a wonderful son.
My understanding of this award that Bill is being given on this special occasion is as much about the recipient's abilities as an attorney, a partner in the firm, as it is about the character of the individual and how they lead their lives. I've only known Bill 4 months, but I feel like because of the circumstances under which we got to know each other, I'm proud to call him my friend.
He's been a great example for the rest of the family and children.
when anybody he comes in contact with, they look up to Bill. He did what he had to do, and he did it easily, and all in place like he does everything, and it was well done. I'm very proud of the leadership.
A pillar seems to be an appropriate representation for Bill Honan, steady and constant.
In New York, New York, I want to wake up in that city that doesn't sleep. Come on.
Holland and Knight honors Bill Honan with the 2002 Chesterfield Smith Lawyer Award.